Praise the Lord. Thank you. We're just happy how our young people and Brother Rene and the rest of the guys are really doing an impact in our Bible study and all these things. So we are happy. They will be the next generation of leaders. And I kid you not, I was on a two-day seminar about equipping and discipleship. There were about 1,200. Can I say it right? 1,200 people was there. 99% are Chinese, my relative, and the rest are Filipino and different culture. But we had a wonderful study of God's Word, and I think the emphasis there was, what are we investing on? Who are we investing on? After 10 years, who are the next generation of leaders we will see at our church? And that's why, as your servant here, I am committed to train our young people and our young adults also to study God's Word together. Amen? And to lead this wonderful church. Well, just say God bless you to the person beside you, especially if it's your wife that you haven't said good morning yet. God bless. Before I pray and bless you together, I'm going to be just saying something about this, something candid. One day a man was walking along the beach and he tripped over a lamp. He turned around and kicked the lamp out of anger. And a few later seconds, a genie came out of the lamp. But the genie was also angry with the guy because his lamp was kicked. Reluctantly, the genie said to him, "Even though you kicked me, I still have to give you 3 wishes. However, because of what you did, I will give you as twice of what you wish for the person that you hate the most." Don't look at the person beside you, the boss. So the man agreed about the first wish, and he said, "I want lots of money. And to be exact, I want $22 million. Immediately, $22 million came to his bank account, but would you believe, also $44 million went to the boss account. The second wish was this. He said, "I like cars. I cannot afford cars. Give me sports car." Instantly, Lamborghini, Ferrari, and Porsche appeared on his garage, and most of you know, according to the genie, the boss will also get twice of what he wished for. Finally, the genie said, "This is your last wish. You should choose carefully." The gentleman paused for a while and then thought and said, "I always wanted to donate a kidney." So the boss has to donate 2 kidneys. Let us pray. Lord, we invite you. It's all about you. And we ask that the Holy Spirit will speak volumes of truth in our lives. Lord, not only a head knowledge, but a transforming, O Lord, in our lives. Transforming knowledge. As you promised us in the book of 2 Corinthians 5:17, that if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. Let it be, O Lord, in our lives. We are not perfect people, but we know we have a perfect Savior who is always at work in our lives. To God be the glory alone, in Jesus' name, amen and amen. If you have your sermon notes with you, I'm going to be tackling a topic that probably will, as they said, open a can of worms. What do you mean by that, Pastor? We have been studying, and this is my 4-part series about overcoming. We talk about problem-free living. We talk about worry-free living. We talk about guilt-free living. And today, we're going to be talking and daring by faith to have an angry-free living. And we're going to name it. Say to the person beside you, "Hoy, you listen, angry-free living. Is it possible?" Some of you are laughing now to your friends. Most of us can remember being deeply hurt by people, we know that. Unless we know from the scriptures of how to deal with people who hurt us, don't you know that the memory of that hurt will scar our past, it will sadden our present, and it will shackle us in the future. Genesis chapter 37 and following speaks to us about a person, the name Joseph, one of the great biblical example of how Joseph responded to the people that hurt him. And if you are there, our reference is Romans chapter 12, but most of you came from Sunday school, you know about Genesis chapter 37. As a young boy, Joseph is hated and despised by his brothers. He was sold into slavery, would you believe, by his brothers for 20 shekels or 20 pieces of silver. His brother was upset with him because we know for a fact that in Genesis, before Genesis 37, he had a dream that he will be used by God, but he cannot interpret properly. Joseph's dream was this. He said, I will be a king and a ruler, and I will reign over you, brothers. And the brothers was upset with him. And that's why when they saw him in verse 18 of chapter 37, this is the intention of the brothers. He said, there is Joseph, the dreamer. Remember those? Joseph the dreamer. I don't know about your choir or this choir. There was a song about the Joseph the dreamer. They made it as a play. And even in our camp, we tried to attempt that, right? And then when the brothers saw Joseph, their intention is to kill him. Verse 18. Reuben, one of his brothers, said, let's not kill him. Let us just put him on an empty cistern. Sabalon. They were so mad at him because they cannot take any commands or any words from Joseph. And we know in fact that Joseph's dream had happened. He became one of the powerful gentlemen or minister in Egypt. As I was reading Genesis chapter 37, I was surprised, brothers and sisters, that when he was about to be thrown in the balloon or in the empty cistern, there was calmness on him. If you are there in chapter 37, there was no shouting and fighting and arguing. He was just thrown. And I had to take a look at the second time around of Genesis 37. What was his reaction? There was calmness in him. And I can prove to you that there is calmness in him because of his, watch this, trust in God. He was thrown, he was sold, he was put into Egypt. And then what the Bible said to us also here is that when Genesis 39 comes to us, he was accused wrongfully. By who? By Mrs. Potiphar. I like it in Genesis chapter 39 verse 6. In the King James Version, they read it differently. I like King James Version here and there. And let me read it to you from the scripture. And Pharaoh said, he left, Potiphar said, and he left all that he had in Joseph's hand, and he knew not aught that he had. He just had to save bread for him to eat. And Joseph was a goodly person. Goodly. Pastor, I think you made a mistake. I think what you meant is godly. But if you have a King James Version, I was surprised that the NIV and any other version never speaks about this. Goodly. G-O-O-D-L-Y. What does it mean, Pastor? He was attractive and admirable. He is handsome. And watch this. He has a good form. Macho. So if you are here, wife, and you are with your husband, say to him, you are goodly. Macho. Macho nuri. Mag-sign ka na dyan. Maglaba ka na dyan. You know, kidding aside, this is what the Bible described. And he said, he is well-favored. That's why we can understand now that Mrs. Potiphar, watch this, lusted over Joseph. You remember what happened to him in verse 9 of Genesis 39. He said, how can I sin against God? Because every day Mrs. Potiphar approached him and said, lie with me. My husband is not here. But because he is godly, he is goodly, and he is well-favored, he said, how can I sin against God? And it is not just a mental ascent that God could be there. It is because of his relationship with God. There is nothing we can resist in this world. And mind you, that the temptation that we have in this world can only be overcome if we are close to God. Pastor, I've been a Christian for long. I've been in this church for long. I have scars of battles, spiritually speaking. I am mature. I am strong. Watch your word. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, the Bible said, those who think they are standing firm, be careful you do not fall. We should not boast about how many years we are in the ministry. Because everybody has imperfection in his life. I like that. Joseph did not only say, you know, brothers, if you're going to do this to me, I will let it happen because I know that God has a purpose. He was put on a cistern. He was wrongfully accused and put into prison by Mrs. Potiphar. And then later on, as most of you know, he was spending many, many years in the jail, and he helped the Pharaoh's butler about a dream, to interpret a dream. And the Pharaoh's butler said to him, okay, I promise you that I will deliver you. I will ask the Pharaoh to set you free. 2 years after, 2 years is a long, long time, nothing happened until Joseph was released because he interpreted the dream of the Pharaoh. He eventually became the prime minister of Egypt. And probably if he became a prime minister of Egypt, the first question would be something like this: where is Mrs. Potiphar who accused me of rape when in the first place I run away? Where is the butler who promised me that he will deliver me from jail and I've been here for 2 years? That would be the intention of Joseph. But watch this. The intention of Joseph is this: because he have a higher understanding of the hardship that he faced, he let go of these things and he keep on serving God. We talk about Joseph's dream. We talk about his calmness. We talk about Genesis 39, how can I sin against God? We talk about his devotion. But on the later part, mind you, 2 years of being in jail for wrongfully accused, Joseph's determination, Genesis 41, verse 1, he has unwavering and firmness in God's word. I remember before when I was still an associate pastor of this church, and it's always a privilege, I was reminded by what happened to the storm when Jesus was there. He was sleeping and the disciples were panicking, and to some of us, that is a natural reaction. And I think I said to the congregation at the time that it does not matter how many people are in the boat or professional fishermen. What matters the most, brothers and sisters, is if Jesus is in your boat. It is not how many supply we have in the boat. It is not how many who rows the boat. It is the question of, is Jesus in your boat? Why? Because Jesus is a majority for all of us. He can overcome our toughest need, our hardest need, and he will always be there. And Pastor, where are you coming from with this? Again, Genesis 39, the privilege of studying God's word. Verse 19, listen to this. He was thrown into the prison. Check, Pastor, I was listening to that. But the Lord was with him. God was with Joseph and showed him his faithful love to Joseph. And the Lord made Joseph a favorite within the prison warden. That's why he became a person who controls the prison. The Lord was with him. Can I say this to you, that if you are in the Lord, whatever hardship we are facing, God never leaves. He is in us. The Bible said, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. Can you say to the person beside you, the Lord is with you? And to the next person on the side, para naman hindi magtampo. When it seems God is not with you, he is always there for you. How can we live an angry-free living? And this is an attempt for all of us by the graces of God. Remember Genesis 41, let me continue on if you are with me. Joseph marries a young woman and had two sons. Bible school student, Sunday school student, you know this. The sons is Manasseh and Ephraim. What is so special to this pastor? You see, in biblical times, names were chosen because of their meaning. Today, to some people, names are chosen because of their sound. When Manasseh was born, Joseph had decided in his heart to name him Manasseh. Why? Genesis 41, verse 51, let me read it to you. Joseph named the firstborn Manasseh, meaning God has made me forget, watch this, all my hardship in my father's hand. I like that. That's why the meaning of Manasseh is forgetting. Forget.